Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here. I can see some of you in the audience, and thank you, Kyle.
Oh, thanks for having me.
I do want to call out and double the thanks to my mom for putting the flowers up here. I've told this story before, but one day I was sloughing off in Brew drinking coffee, and there was this older woman trudging through the blizzard putting up posters for the National Writer Series, and I realized it was my mother. And she and my father, Daryl, worked really tirelessly for lots of great stuff in town, so it's kind of a family affair. Let's start by talking about family. Angie Morgan brought up some of that. I've got to know you a bit today. We went to Front Street Writers. You were terrific. We were driving around, and each time I asked you another question, I found out that Kyle did one other thing. First, I learned that you like to build furniture. You rebuilt a bike for your wife. Then we met Clark Miller, who's our musician tonight. Thank you, Clark. And Kyle told me that he also plays classical guitar. And then I thought next he was going to tell me that he hang glides or has his jet pilot's license. You are really an accomplished guy. And you say you have a lot of hobbies. And you live in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. So tell us about your life in Wyoming.
Well, I moved there many years ago on a lark because I was a really serious rock climber. And I lived in Baltimore, which was not a good place to do it. And I convinced my girlfriend, who is now my wife, to move out. We thought, well, we'll stay a year or two, do a little climbing, do a little mountain biking, and it'll be fun, ski. And we never left. So it's a wonderful place to live and full of incredibly interesting people. It's, you're sitting around and three people at the table have summited Everest. And or, you know, I was having dinner with somebody recently, and he said, I just spent the last 6 months in North Korea. And you think, why? And he said, I thought it'd be cool.
Really?
And so, you know, it's I've learned an enormous amount from the people who live there.
What do you do, before we get to the Mitch Rapp series and your Mark Beeman books and so on, tell us about, the audience might want to know about just your how you got started writing, because Angie referenced this, and you talked with the students today. It's 1995, approximately?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
You're working at a bank in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, doing loans. Mm-hmm. You're an econ major from James Madison University in Virginia. And you said something amazing today at Front Street Writers in front of these students. You'd never taken a creative writing course or thought of yourself as a writer, and you sat down to write a novel. And so yeah. How did that happen?
Well, I needed a hobby, and I didn't do any. So I was a corporate banker, and I didn't do anything creative. I'd work at the bank all day, and then I'd climb usually in the afternoons, and that's pretty much my life.
Would you free climb or rope?
Yeah. Well,
protected or
you have a rope you take up with you. So yeah, I didn't. So what's called solo. Now that is a bad idea. So I thought I need to do something creative, and I was going to, you said, well, I've taken it up since, but I said I was going to build furniture. I thought that'd be a lot of fun. And my wife said, but you're not very handy, which was a fair comment. And she said, well, why don't you write a novel? And I think she really just didn't want me to put a bunch of tools so she couldn't park in the garage.
Was she joking? I mean, had you indicated an interest in writing a novel?
I don't know where she came up with that. It was just, I think it was really out of fear of shoveling her car out every morning. She was just, yeah, it could have been chef, and now I'd be a chef. So I had never done anything like that before. I'd never done any creative writing. I wrote a nice business letter, I thought. But it kind of got into my head. I thought, yeah, that would be a really fun creative process. So being a very methodical guy, I went out and bought a bunch of how to write a book novel, like, you know, how to write a novel for dummies and all that kind of stuff. And I read them all and thought, yeah, this will be great. And I had a father who had been in the FBI his entire life, so I knew a lot of those people. I thought that would make the research easier. So there's a little bit of laziness maybe there. I'm going to write a thriller novel. I'd loved them as a kid. And that ended up being the fastest book I ever wrote, strangely. And it eventually got published and became a bestseller. So So, and oddly, I signed a 2-book deal, but I had never planned on writing a second book.
First piece of furniture you made was a violin, or
no. I still can't cut a straight line. It's terrible.
All right, we'll just have to back up.
I want to emphasize that I don't do any of these things well. I just do a lot of the things.
You're also learning Spanish too.
Yes, which I also do poorly.
Yeah, I don't. You know, after a while, you just do so many. It doesn't matter because people never discover you do them poorly because they're impressed. So,
I don't have children, which I think is a huge time saver.
Yeah,
this is what I'm told.
This feels like some form of birth control here, but I don't know. So we'll pause for a moment on this. You just decided to write a novel. You got something novel for dummies. I don't understand how you actually wrote it. Did you call up Dad and say, "Hey, Dad, I'm writing a novel about the FBI"? Did he groan? Did he say, "Oh, I can't tell you anything"? Or what was his response?
Well, you know, my father, like most fathers, never is bashful about criticizing me. And so I think he thought it was kind of a stupid idea, but it was a stupid idea. I mean, it was an incredibly stupid idea. But for me, it was a fun thing, really. Like I said, I was serious when I said I never expected to write another book, and I really thought my mother would read it, and then it would go live in the attic. That was sort of my goal, is that my mom would say something nice about it, and off it would go into the attic. And honestly, it wasn't until my father called me and said, "I read your book and I thought it was really good." And I know that he would, you know, he wasn't lying. If he said that, I thought, "Oh my God, maybe I've got something here and I should try to get it published."
So it does get published. It's called Phoenix Rising. It's published in 1997. It's your first novel. And it becomes a bestseller. So you kind of beat all the odds there that year. I mean, you just somehow, you... And telling the students today about it, I think, was really invigorating for them. They're going to figure out it's not quite so easy all the time, but that's okay.
I leave out the part about the 100 turndowns I got from agents. So I've been turned down. Oh, man, I've been turned down by every dignified agent in New York, from New York to L.A. Yes, absolutely.
But you found one agent. And you still have the same agent?
No, I don't, actually. Oh. But, yes, I did find one.
Right. So let's talk about your father for a moment, because it relates then to the Mitch Rapp series. You are graduating from college in 1988. You're in London. I don't know why you're in London, but we'll find out. But during your college graduation party, the Lockerbie bombing happens, right? And your father gets a phone call at the table. He has to get up and go somewhere, because why? What's he doing?
So... the reason I was in London is my father was the legal attaché, which is a fancy way of saying the FBI agent that covers the UK, and he worked in the embassy there. So when Lockerbie happened, I was having my college graduation dinner at a restaurant, and actually his assistant came in, it's before cell phones, and said, "You know, a plane has gone down a little town in Scotland. We think it might just have been a malfunction, but we're not sure." And then off he went a little while later after dinner, and I didn't see him again for months. That was a huge, I don't know if people remember it, but I mean, it was a tiny town. They had a couple of constables, and he had to move in and move a huge number of FBI agents in and start mapping out everything. I mean, people were scattered for enormous amount of territory, and in the woods and in the bogs and everything, and deal with all that. Which was not only a monumental task, but a really incredibly heartbreaking task. You know, he had people would call and say, "You know, I don't want to bother you. I know you're really busy, but there are these two kids sitting in my backyard, and they've been there for 2 days, and I'd really like you to come and get them." And he had to say, "You know, we're bringing in, I mean, we have C-130s coming in, everything. We're bringing in people, but you're just going to have to close the curtains. And I'm going to get there as soon as I can." So it was just a really awful thing to work on.
Now, who did that act, the bombing? Do we know?
The Libyans. Probably. That's right. In retaliation for us bombing them. Yeah,
right.
They'd gotten mad at Reagan about that.
That's right. Now, does that bombing figure at all into Vince Flynn's universe. Did that figure into the Mitch Rapp series? Go ahead. Yeah.
Well, so that's an interesting, and I had forgotten about this when I took the job because I had read the books so long ago, Vince's books over many, many years, like many people have, that he got into that because his girlfriend was on that plane in the book. So a piece of shared history, strange shared history.
Right. So what is the Mitch Rapp universe and who is Mitch Rapp?
Well, Mitch Rapp is, he's actually not a complicated guy. I think people sometimes get mad at me for calling him an assassin, but I think it's probably on his business card. And I remind them that his origin story is a book called American Assassin. So he is a CIA agent who works primarily in the Middle East and on Middle Eastern terrorism issues. And he's been doing it since he graduated from college and went to CIA training. And now he's about 44. So it's a terrific book series that Vince started. So you get to watch this guy change and mature over what it would be more than 20 years now. And it's kind of fascinating to watch. Vince was really very skillful at doing it.
So you've just published Order to Kill, which is the second book you've written in this series. And there are 14 Mitch Rapp books, I think, that Vince Flynn...
14 or 15. 14. 15, yeah. Including the new one, I think.
So what's Order to Kill about? And we'll talk about it then, how you came to write it.
Well, Order to Kill takes Mitch a little out of his comfort zone. I think the fun thing about having a character like that, it's such an iconic character, is you can throw anything you want at him and see how he reacts. So the world is changing. It's funny to think Vince didn't know anything about ISIS or Vladimir Putin rising back onto the world stage. So he's always dealt primarily with kind of Al-Qaeda and limited scope terrorist groups. And I wanted to throw Russia at him. I have an economics major, I think you mentioned, and so I'm really fascinated with the reduction in oil prices and energy prices and its effect on a lot of these smaller oil-dependent countries. Obviously, Russia's the largest country in the world, but has a fairly small economy, very much dependent on this. Think of countries like Venezuela, Iran. And so Russia is a really interesting case in that people think it's kind of resurgent and it's gaining power, but the truth is very much the opposite. It's kind of cratering. They can't afford anything. They have not learned to build anything or build an economy. It's smaller than Italy's. So the idea here is that Putin, and in my book he's called Krupin, but he's basically the exact same guy with the exact same history. So everything you read about him, which is horrible, is true, is in order to maintain power, which he has to because he has so many enemies and within the oligarchs, he has to figure out a way to get oil prices back up. And so sowing chaos, major chaos in the Middle East would be the way to do that, to cut down on the oil supply and then rebuild his country with the money that he would get from all Russia's resources, which are considerable.
That's interesting. Do you think something like that could happen or has happened?
Well, I know he's wheeling and dealing with the Saudis right now, trying to get them to cut back on their supply, but they'll tell you they're going to do it, and then they just don't. So he's in a real mess, and I mean, not as bad as Venezuela, but he's got serious problems there. They're in a significant recession. They can't pay their bills. The government's going bankrupt. And like I said, he's kind of a wounded animal. The way he took power, it's kind of one of those things that it's great if it works, but when it stops working, you're probably not going to survive very long. So he has to maintain power, and he'll do anything to do that, which makes him in a way more dangerous than the Soviets, who were, you know, a kooky country, but they had systems in place. He controls everything. He basically owns Russia.
How do you know this stuff? Where do you get your information?
Oh, well, I know a lot of people kind of in the intelligence industry. And this is what I do all day is spend time reading and researching these kinds of things, talking to people about it. And for me, and my books have always been, what's an interesting subject that maybe the worldview or the common view is wrong, or there's another view out there that's really interesting. And that's the case with this one, is the idea that Russia is such a resurgent country and that it's becoming very powerful, when the danger is the opposite, that he's losing power and he's doing it at a rate that makes him desperate.
I know that Vince Flynn had a lot of contacts in the intelligence world, both here in the U.S. and abroad. Were you able to maintain those lines of communication when you assumed this authorship? Do you use those guys?
For the most part, I had from my childhood my own. So I've kind of kept the relationships that I have.
Strangest question you've ever called up and asked somebody?
Well, the funniest probably was relating to drugs. I wrote my first book on narcotics. And the DEA had given me some decent information, some friends at the DEA, but I didn't really have everything I needed from them. So I live in a tiny little town and we have one bookstore. So I was getting these books and it never occurred to me that ordering books for like how to build your own methamphetamine lab and poisons and how to use them and everything. And I just kept calling them and ordering. And like a year later, my book came out and everything. And Steve Ashley, he came up to me and he said, "We are so glad you are a novelist." Because we really thought something was going on here.
That's funny. You said something earlier that not the entire audience might have caught, but which is that you, Vince, had written a couple of these books, or a baker's dozen or more, and you took over the authorship. Tell us what happened to Vince and how you came to be the keeper now of the Mitch Rapp story.
Well, Vince was actually quite young. He was a little younger than me and passed away a few years ago of very aggressive prostate cancer. It was kind of a shock when it happened, and my wife called me and told me, and you know, it was a really horrible thing. But one of the things you sort of selfishly think of when somebody like Vince dies is you think, oh no, there aren't going to be any more Mitch Rapp books. And I mean, even I thought about that. And I remember telling my wife, geez, I hope they find somebody good to carry that on and that it keeps going. But I didn't know if it would. And a few days later, oddly, after that conversation, I got a call of somebody saying, well, would you be interested in potentially taking that on? Would you have any ideas about it? And I said, well, gee, you know, I couldn't remember the last book, because I had read it years before. And so I said, let me read that again and let me think about where I'd go with it. So I did, and I called him back and said, these are some kind of initial ideas, but I probably wouldn't do any of those because I'll change my mind 15 times while I'm writing the book. So I'm not really sure what you're going to end up with. And I hung up and I thought, that was the worst job interview I've ever done. I'm never going to get that book.
Is this a publisher?
That was his agent.
Oh, Sloan Ayres?
Yeah, Sloan. And so in the end, they called me back and said, sure, you know, that's fine. I mean, I had given them sort of my thoughts on it, and I think I even used the word, as much as I hate to use it, I use it all the time now, that I wanted to create a forgery. That the last book that Vince wrote, he hadn't finished. I mean, he finished it, but he liked to arc stories over multiple books. So clearly the storyline was going to continue. And that I wanted to finish that thought in exactly the way that he would have, as close as I could come to it. And that no one would ever, would really have ever known if my name wasn't on the front that it was me and not Vince.
You had he had 2.5 pages of that carryover arc. Do you remember the day you opened those pages as a PDF or in your email, what you felt?
Yeah, well, I guess I'd use the word spooky to read it because, you know, it had all the misspellings and Vince was dyslexic and just kind of like what one of my first drafts would look like. And to read it like that was really interesting. It was generally just a recap, really. It was the beginning of a recap of what had happened in the last book so he could continue on this storyline. And so I'm a really kind of meticulous writer. I do big outlines and I do a lot of research and I do all that stuff before I start. So I thought, well, this isn't going to be that bad. Just have Lisa, his wife, send me over, you know, the box of stuff. And I see, you know, and they said, what box? And I said, well, it'll be outlines and post-its and all this research and where he's going with the book. And they said, no, there's no box. That's 2.5 pages. That's what you got. And I thought I probably should have asked these questions before I took the job.
Because at this point, Vince Flynn had sold how many Mitch Rapp books?
You know, I honestly don't even know.
Let's make up a number. It's okay.
Millions, yeah. And tens of millions of books. For sure.
So you're about to really inhabit this new iconic character who's absorbed around the world, really, and it's got to be a daunting task. Did you get any guidance about what not to do with the character? Because I know there might be people in the audience who are rabid Mitch Rapp fans. Places you shouldn't go, or he shouldn't probably start doing yoga, or
Flower arranging was out. No. Interestingly, so I was almost on the other side of that with Sloan, his agent, that he was, I think, almost more amenable to me opening it up and exploring different things than I was. But I thought, I'm going to just get killed. Somebody's going to shoot my porch light out or something if I do anything different. And so I said, no, this first one is going to be, I'm just rolling my ball down the middle of the lane. I'm going to use his word choice. I'm going to really create a forgery. No, nothing new in this book. And that's what I shot for. So everybody was pretty amenable to me, probably feeling a little freer than I did. But I don't know if that would be true of the fans. So, and I'm still not sure if that's true of the fans. They've cut me some slack, but I think you got to be careful what you do with it.
So what is the story that you're telling? Let's talk about the thriller genre. I know the audience, we like to read these books, you know. In some ways, Mitch Rapp's really like, what you were talking about was Game of Thrones there for a moment with Putin. I mean, he's in such a place that it is Game of Thrones. And in some ways, Rapp seems to be like this errant knight who's going around the world fighting the forces of evil. And that way with the students today, I was hoping that they would really see that this isn't too far off from the fantasy novels they're reading. It's this archetypal arc. So do you think any of that's true about what's going on with Rapp today in the world? And I mean, what is he representing or resonating with?
What I always liked about those books and why they were very different than mine. So my books, another word I hate to use, unsatisfying, but my books were very gray. I saw the world in tones of gray. Sometimes the bad guy, you weren't really sure who the bad guy and the good guy were. There was a lot of overlap there. And sometimes the resolution was less than satisfying, which I think is realistic in the world today. But it's also complicated and it's exhausting, just like, you know, the real world today, if you were to look at the Middle East in particular. Vince's books, why I always loved them, is they were much more linear than that. You had Mitch Rapp was a good guy, and no matter what he did, and sometimes he does some awful things, he was good and true, and he was doing them for the right reasons. You then had the bad guys who were very evil, and in the end, the bad guy got theirs. For instance, he, in writing whatever it was, 14 books about the Middle East, I don't think he ever used the words Sunni and Shiite, because it was more of a monolithic enemy. And that's what's fun about them. You knew Mitch was going to win. You just wanted to see how he did it. The bad guys were going to get theirs in the end, and it would be over. The plot, the evil plot, would be over. And, you know, that's a fun formula. That's why I always bought his books right when they came out. You know, it's just a fun read, and you felt good at the end that, you know, goodness defeated evil.
Vince passed away in June of 2013, so you've written two of these, but previous to 13, you were publishing the Mark Beeman books, you wrote a book about the tobacco industry. Tell us about that just for a moment, because I think it's so interesting, Kyle, how you will take an, like Jodi Picoult, who was here recently, you'll take an issue and figure out how it can become alive as a novel. It's a very interesting view of the novel as engaging with the world, which is why I think these books are important, because when you read them, you can see a certain way of what the world is thinking. And so, but tell us about the tobacco book, Smokescreen.
Well, that just, so my books weren't necessarily series books. It was just things that I got interested in. And I thought, well, now I can just really plow into this subject and I'll write a book about it. Give me a good excuse. And that one was, I had read a book called, there's a brilliant book called Ashes to Ashes. It's the history of the tobacco industry. And I thought, this is just the most interesting book I've ever read. It's like the size of the Bible. And I just couldn't put it down. I thought, I've got to write a book about the tobacco industry. And I'm always interested in a new challenge for writing. And that's sort of one of the reasons that taking Vince on was such an interesting challenge. I thought, can I write a book that nobody can tell the difference? I mean, to me, that was the exciting, probably the most exciting part about taking that on. It's something I'd never tried. And so with this book, I thought, can I write a book that people would be interested in that nobody gets shot? Because, you know, it's a little bit of a cheat, really. You know, you think, oh, it's getting a little boring here. I'll just shoot somebody. You can always do that in a thriller novel.
They just get lung cancer in this book. And,
kind of a slow, it's hard to get really a page turner out of that. And I also wanted to write a book, not to get too technical, but in the first person. So as a narrator that says, I did this, I did that. I'd never done that before. It's not that common in thriller. So I thought, I'm going to combine those two things and really, I'm either going to succeed or I'm going to fall flat on my face, and we'll see which one it is. And it was really a lot of fun, and my fans liked it. It's terrible to go out and warn people after you've written a book and say, you know, to all your fans, well, this isn't exactly what I've done before, but work with me here. I think you're going to like it. And it turned out to be, oddly, one of my more popular books. I got a ton of mail about that one. This was back in the old days when they couldn't email you. They had to sit down and write you out a letter. So,
do you enjoy writing? Do you enjoy this job? Yeah.
I do. I didn't for a long time. I have to say, I sort of... After the first book was a lot of fun. It's always fun to write. I highly recommend writing a book and then not doing anything with it, just throwing it away when you're done. But I'd signed that second book deal, and suddenly, because the first one was a bestseller, there's a huge amount of pressure. Deadlines, people saying they don't think this plot is saleable or don't like these characters, and there's a million people all of a sudden paying attention to you. And I was young at the time, I may be 30, 31 or something, when I was trying to write the second book, which, if you remember, I never had planned to do. And I finally, my hands shook all the time and my stomach hurt. And I finally one late night said to my wife, do you care if I just quit and just go back to the bank? And she said, no, I'd love it if you would do that. And it was back during fax machines. I wrote myself a nice letter. I said, I haven't spent any of the money you gave me, so I'm just going to send it back, and I quit. And I got sent that to my agent, and I got a call very early the next day saying, if I tell some people that no one can call you, will you produce a book about anything you want? And I said, oh, sure, under those circumstances, I'd be happy to do that. And that became my first New York Times bestseller, actually, when it was done. And so since then, the pressure, I feel like at some point you get confident that, yes, I can produce another book. I will have another idea. It will be okay. But it took years, I think, for that to happen for me. And so now it's fun.
That's great. What would you tell people who want to write a book? You talked today about inhabiting the world of a serial killer, that you had a female protagonist and that person, and it got really hard to, because you are somewhat of a method writer. You want to become the character?
Yeah, for me, it's applied schizophrenia. You become that character. I imagine what it's like. I don't know anything about acting, but what an actor must feel like. They become that character, and then that character just sort of channels through them. For me, that's the way writing is. So I sort of become Mitch Rapp, which is probably the easiest I've ever done because there's such a long history of him, much longer than I've ever written.
What does that mean, though, Kyle? When you become, I mean, you'd walk differently, talk differently?
Yes.
Does Kim notice these things, your wife?
She did during the serial killer book, let me tell you. So that book was, I had never written from the point of view of a woman, like, I mean, obviously, short passages, but the
Tell
hero,
us about them.
So that was the heroine of the book, was this young woman named Quinn. And so when I was writing from her point of view, you know, I really had to feel like, what would it feel like to be this young woman? She was an FBI, worked for the FBI. And then that wasn't too bad. I finally got that, but I pace around, and it's hard if it's not, a lot of writers write, they're all thriller writers, right? They're alter ego, the person they'd want to be, you know. Tom Clancy wanted to be Jack Ryan, and Vince wanted to be Mitch Rapp. But I don't write that way at all. So, you know, I'd pace around, and I'd finally get Quinn in my head, and then I'd write from her point of view. But the much worse one was the serial killer, who was as horrifying as you can imagine person. But I would pace around until I kind of felt justified killing all kinds of people. And my wife liked the young woman just fine, but she was not crazy about the serial killer at all. So that was the end of my foray into serial killer books. I've never done another one. I don't think I ever would. I'm not sure how people do that for a living. Like if you were Patricia Cornwell or something, it's a very dark place to be, I think.
What would you say to yourself, though, as you pace? I'm always curious about writers' tricks. Like, would you say, I'm Quinn, or?
Not so much. I mean, I think about their history. I think about all the things they've done from when they were little kids. It's exactly what you might do if you were just thinking about your life. You were walking down the street and you were thinking about your life. I went to grade school here. These were my friends who were important to me. You were thinking about wonderful experiences you had with your family or really bad experiences you've had in your life. And eventually, you'd kind of get there. But again, you know, if you're doing a serial killer, well, then you're just sitting there for a half an hour pacing around thinking of all these people you've murdered horribly, which is, it works. It got me there, but it takes a while to get out of character at the end of the night. And so that was kind of a little problematic. My wife couldn't understand why I was such in a jerky mood all the time. And that was it. And I didn't even realize it until probably a year later that I figured it out.
How long does it take you to write a book? How long were you?
About a year.
A year, wow.
So with the first Mitch Rapp, when The Survivor, it took me longer because I had to sit down and read all those books again in order. So 6,512 pages. I sat there with a calculator and figured it out before I did it. Before I let them set my deadline. And then took, you know, like 150 pages of notes.
And Vince was much more of a seat of the pants writer. I was interested to learn that you outlined voluminously, but he didn't. How did he compose? Do you know?
You know, he's just one of those guys that could sit down and start on page one and off he'd go. And some people can do that. The oddest one was Tom Clancy. That's how he wrote those books. Those big 1,200-page books with all those subplots and stuff. Just sat down and said, page one. Does not work for me. I tried it a little bit with the Vince, trying to think, well, maybe I should write like Vince in order to produce a book that's like Vince's, but it actually doesn't work. That you use your process to produce whatever you're going to produce. You can't use somebody else's.
If you could write any book that's not a Vince Flynn book or a Mark Beeman book, what would it be?
So you're going to find this a little odd. The whole book forgery thing, I think, is really an interesting challenge and really fun. I would love to try to do Maya Angelou. Because it would be unbelievably hard. But I want her family to call and say, we want to say there was a hidden novel that we found, and we want you to write it, and you don't ever have to tell anybody, and we're never going to tell anybody, and to see if people would say, wow, that was a great Maya Angelou book. I love that.
Why her, though?
Because it's as far as you can get from anything I've ever done, I think.
And you like that challenge.
Yeah.
Is that why you took up furniture making?
Yeah. I like doing things that are hard for some reason. And I did. And that's when people ask me, it's sort of like, why did you climb Everest? Because it was there. They say, why do you do that? And I say, because it's hard.
Because you were living in D.C., right? And then moved to West Virginia? No, you moved...
Baltimore. D.C. Well, London, between there, and then back to Baltimore.
But your move to Wyoming was really to get out in the woods, to be around rock climbing. You're a big mountain biker. You like to ski.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a really lively community in Jackson Hole, right?
Oh, yeah.
But you end up in a bank selling loans. What was that like? I mean,
the
alarm goes off.
Well, you know, I was an econ major, and I actually liked it. It was hard. You know, it was one of those things. I built hotels and office buildings and things like that. And, you know, people think, oh, you got into writing because, you know, the banking was so horrible. And it's actually not true at all. I liked the people I worked with, and the developers were all really interesting. And we built big buildings, which I thought was fascinating. So... I have to say that it wasn't really out of hating the economic stuff.
You know,
it was
like,
just something new.
You're like MacGyver, I think.
I could do anything. It's funny because my wife she describes Muir as like squirrel, and you know, it's just like whatever rabbit hole happens to be around, I'm right down it.
Well, you know, Kyle, it's amazing to I imagine the alarm goes off, you go to the bank, and then one day, you know, Kim says to you, why don't you write that novel? And you do. I'm so glad she did. It's an interesting moment. And it's instructive for all of us to go for that impulse or go for that dream. And the hardest lesson to learn is to keep your butt in the chair, I think. And how, you know, and keep working. I know that's true for me. How many hours a day do you work? And
It really depends.
Are you a procrastinator?
No, not too bad. I have my whole world lined out. So I, you know, every day I know what chapter and how much I have to write in order to hit my deadline.
Is this written down?
Oh, yeah. It's on a spreadsheet. Yeah, it's not just written down. It's got, there's calculations and stuff.
An econ major.
Oh, yeah. And I just have to, so I have the fancy spreadsheet. So if I ever get behind one, I can just, that I got behind one and then it repopulates the spreadsheet. So it reschedules everything for me. My editors love me because Vince never got a book done on time.
So the spreadsheet, if day one, 1,000 words, that kind of thing?
Yeah, well, it's weekly, but yeah. And so I write the outline. So I have to have, you know, your outline has got to be done to here and to there. And then you get your research. And now it says, now I'm cleaning it up. And then if I do everything, I think that's the way. You never want to look at writing a novel or a long nonfiction piece or something as one thing, because it would drive you insane. There's no way anybody sane could look at a blank page and go, this is going to become a 450-page novel. So you always have to think of it as, well, if I do 2 pages today, and then I do 2 pages tomorrow, eventually I'll have 450 pages. And so that's kind of what it is. I never really look ahead. I just looked at the next week as to what I need to do.
Mm-hmm. It's like John Updike's advice to novelists. He said it's like driving a car at night. You only see as far as the headlights.
Yeah.
But that's only as far as you need to see. You travel a lot, too, in the midst of all this productivity. I've seen pictures of you in Istanbul and Laos. You're headed to Spain soon. What's that about?
Well, one, I like to travel, and my wife really, really likes to travel. But also, I don't like to write about places I haven't been. So I try to go as many places as I can, and they come up. If they don't come up immediately, if I'm not actually going on a research trip, they'll come up later. And then I've got a real flavor for that place. It makes it much easier to write. And one of the benefits of being a writer is freedom. It's the thing I like best about it, actually, is I can work from anywhere. So why not, if you can do it?
Are you in the middle of the next Mitch Rapp book? Are you composing now?
I just finished the first draft a few days ago.
Wow, congratulations.
So it sounds better than it is, my first drafts. I only let my mom read them. They're terrible. So it's there's still a lot of work to be done.
What does it look like, your first draft? Is it a pile of pages with a lot of typos?
Oh, yeah. A lot of typos. It's funny because, you know, on Word, you can see that red underline, and it's just, I might as well just underline the whole thing in red, and then it would be less distracting. Yeah, and a lot of notes. So whenever I'm not sure of something or I don't like something, it gets two question marks because then it's searchable on that, and then I write, what? You know, what are you thinking here? Or, you know, I don't know much about guns, which is funny because my father was a firearms instructor and I live in Wyoming, so everybody thinks I probably have 50 guns, but I've never owned a gun. And
have
so,
you shot a gun?
Like, oh, yeah, because my father taught me when I was a kid, when he was a firearms instructor. But it was sort of one of those things, even as a kid, I kind of could take it or leave it. So, like, all that stuff has to go through a consultant that I work with. So I don't make mistakes. I don't even know enough about guns. I know a fair amount about intelligence, so I know what to ask, but I don't even know enough about guns to ask intelligent questions, so I just have to send them the whole page. If somebody's got a gun, I send them the whole page and make sure I haven't said anything incredibly stupid, which I usually have.
It's interesting because you are, I think, a more cerebral person than Mitch Rapp, and your protagonist of the Beeman novels, if I recall correctly, you said was a smoker, and he, if the criminal was running away, he would say something like, "That's all right, he'll come back. I'll just sit here and wait for him." And whereas Rapp would have been sprinted, you know, in 100 yards. So, what does that say, though, about the ability of the mind and the imagination to make that leap? Because you've made one, and it's curious.
Yeah, my character was much more, kind of more of a Sherlock Holmes, kind of very, my characters have always been very imperfect. I wrote a book called Fade that was probably my most military thriller. It was about a Navy SEAL, but he had just had a complete, I mean, the guy was 14 cards short of a full deck. He drove around in a big Cadillac with the top down, listening to the Go-Go's all the time and killing people remorselessly. And so that was always the characters I wrote, were extremely quirky and flawed. And so taking on somebody like Mitch is a really different, it's just a really different challenge, but sort of an iconic type of character. I mean, he is essentially a superhero. So, and people will sometimes say, oh, well, you know, does he have a cape under his shirt? And that's kind of the point. That's what makes him fun. It's sort of like I always compare him to the outlaw Josie Wales, if you like Westerns. I love Westerns. And you never worried that Josie Wales was going to get killed by somebody. I mean, he was superhuman. You were interested to see him kill everybody else. And that's the way I see Mitch. He's very much the master of his own universe. He is always in charge. He is really always right. And you have to be really careful to keep that, because it's not necessarily the way I am personally. I just recently, I normally never go back. After I've written a chapter, no matter how bad it is, I never go back until I'm done the book, because you can kind of get into a loop. And I recently was really tired, and I wrote a chapter where Mitch just sort of went along. He just didn't want to fight, and he just sort of went along. And I thought, oh my God, that's the worst chapter I've ever written in my life. This is horrible. I spent the whole night awake thinking, like, literally, this is the way writers are. They're like, have I lost my ability to write? Did I have a small stroke? Is this, you know, and you're just going through this in your head. And the next day I had to go back and actually put it right. But I think it was because that's the way I was feeling that it came through.
Yeah, he surrendered.
Yeah, he just surrendered. Exactly. It was awful.
It's interesting to hear you, you know, we're talking. The killing is not, it's what's interesting in the American kind of mind or psyche is, it's a way in these fables, because they're fables or legends. You're really telling a superhero story. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not a graphic novel, but it could be, interestingly enough. So the destruction is about a way of keeping score. It's an interesting, it's a different calculus, a moral calculus, and it might be one of the reasons for the popularity of the books. So it'd be interesting to see you do the Maya Angelou book in light of that. It would be so very different. Are there any clues about the next rap book that you can divulge? Or how many, where's he going? Tell us this. Where is he going, or where do you think you can tell us he's going to end up?
Well, I mean, he's kind of continuing his journey now. The character, you know, it started when he was in college. He was a little naive. He became sort of the Mitch Rapp we all knew and loved, you know, the incredibly tough, superhuman kind of guy. His wife died, was killed, actually. He became very frustrated and angry. And I thought maybe too much so. So when I took over, I've sort of started, and when I say too much so, I don't mean too much so in the context of where the character would be if his wife and unborn child had been killed. I think it was very realistically and very skillfully done. But it was, you're kind of like, whoa, Mitch, you're going too far now. And I thought he was in danger of becoming a bit more of an anti-hero than he needed to be. So with that first book, I started pulling him back a little bit to what he was before his wife had died. And with this book, it continues. So, I mean, that journey, every character has to run through that arc. Every human being runs through that arc of being young, being older, and learning new things from the people and situations you're exposed to. So now he's thinking about a relationship. He's toning some of his frustration down. And he's having to face a new world that's unlike some of the challenges that he faced when Vince was alive, because the world continues to change and thrillers have to be very current and have to feel very current or they're not a lot of fun.
Hero, anti-hero. It's interesting. We haven't heard that word anti-hero in a while.
Well, I think that's what it is. Well, I guess it would have a little bit of a different connotation to everybody, but, you know, Mitch Rapp is a really brutal guy. He's as brutal as the people he fights. So when you come right down to it, the difference between him and the terrorists is motivation. It's not necessarily so much method. And to me, that's kind of a classic anti-hero. Mm-hmm. But it can be disturbing to read if you're not very much on that character's side, because things can get a little blurred morally.
We don't have many anti-heroes, though, these days. I mean, remember that movie Five Easy Pieces with Jack mm-hmm. Nicholson? Anyone see that?
Yeah.
Randall Patrick McMurphy and One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. It's usually, and this is changing, thankfully, but it was usually a male who was in opposition to some bureaucracy or the man or some large. But it's funny, these days I find people to be so much more transactional. They don't want to be oppositional to the man. They want to become part of the system. They want to, so maybe that's why Mitch seems more iconic. He's more idiosyncratic.
And I think cathartic to some right. way. I mean, doesn't everybody want to pistol whip somebody at least once a day? Well, he does it. You know, he's not bashful about it. And or the politicians he deals with.
But
you
wait,
know, I mean, that's...
Is this what my loan officer at the bank is thinking as I'm
exactly.
sitting?
I guarantee that.
Warren?
And so, you know, and the politicians he deals with and everything. I mean, how many of us don't want to slam the guy against a wall and choke him with their forearm, you know? And he gets to do it. And I think that's one of the things that's really fun about those books.
It's like the movie Network, you know, I'm mad as hell.
Yeah, exactly.
So
I'm
that's
not
my
take
point.
It anymore.
This is what these novels and this genre is fulfilling. It's a wish fulfillment kind of thing. Then our psyches are kind of, the writer Jim Harrison, I remember once we were talking, he said, you know, you can always tell when these things happen in America because it means that the pressure is too great and the thing is escaping out of the crack and it's becoming fully formed into something new. And so it's been interesting to hear you talk about Mitch that way. A series of novels I've read since they started coming out. Vince came to my first book reading in Minneapolis when In Harm's Way came out a long time ago. He's very generous. He had just published the first, and we have the same agent, Sloan Harris, so it's been a real treat to get to talk to you here about him and kind of about him, too. I asked you to read earlier. We won't do that. But is there anything you'd like to say in closing? You could read a poem to your wife, or it'd be fun if I had the serial killer book. I'd actually have you read a page from that right now.
No. Let me tell you, I just want to forget that thing ever happened.
I'm sorry. That sounds terrible.
Well, and worse is that people would read it, and then they'd ask my wife if she was afraid to live with me. Like, that's not a joke. And I'm thinking, you've been friends with me for years. Like,
your
well,
friends?
Yeah, but I didn't know you thought about stuff like this. And I never, and then I found out later, James Patterson, I thought, well, he does this stuff all the time. I found out he doesn't take his mail. So it just goes to his agent, so he never reads it. But I was getting letters from, I had a woman write me a letter that she signed in disgust. And it was horrible. I thought, but the woman won in the end. And it was just a bad memory. And I didn't even want to do it. My editor put me up to it.
When is the next rap novel coming out? Do you know?
I'm not exactly sure. They normally come out in October.
Do you know the title? Okay. Or can you tell us?
I hate titles. I put them off and put them off and put them off, and then nobody ever listens
to me. Is Traverse
City
going to be in the novel? No?
Maybe not. Well, this one's done, so, but maybe never. Maybe the next one.
All right.
One. Everywhere I go eventually makes it.
That's what I was wondering. Well, thank you for ending your book tour here. You've been all over the country, and congratulations on Order to Kill. Let's bring the lights up, if we can, and ask some questions in the audience. We have microphones, as usual.
Thanks.
If you do have a question, raise your hand if you could, and a mic will come to you. And just say your name, please.
My name is Carol Rohde. I'm a huge Mitch Rapp fan. I've read all of them so far. I have them on audiobook. It's kind of an obsession thing. I want to know if you have plans for a really interesting female character coming up.
Yep, the next one. Daryl said, I'm setting it up in this one, and then yes. So yeah, I would say that one of the things about Vince's books is that he did not have, other than Irene Kennedy, who's the CIA chief, who's a very strong and interesting character, he didn't have a lot of women coming in and out of Mitch's life that survived, frankly. So I'm hoping to change that.
I know you don't have the mic, but what do you like about the books? Oh, there's the mic right there.
You know, they're so interesting to me, and it's an escape. I mean, and he's just fascinating. The way he thinks is where his mind goes. It's like almost a game for me to try and see if I can figure out where he's going with something. And I really enjoy that. And I like his relationship with Irene. I mean, I think it's interesting, the two of them.
So they've been together forever before they were, when he was in college and she was, you know, kind of a station chief, and now they've risen to the top of the CIA. So you have this really rich history over their entire lives that you get to know these people. And I think that's one of the compelling things about these series characters. You know them like they're a friend of yours. So you're inherently interested every year to find out what they've been doing. And that's the way I felt.
If I could just say one more thing. Yeah. It was interesting to me to see what was going to happen after Rafiq Aziz was killed.
Yeah.
Because that was kind of ending that whole chapter. And so, okay, where is his focus going to go now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which is, and I think Vince was amazing at that, at building this universe that feels so real to everybody, and all the characters that inhabit it feel really real.
Someone over here. I have a question. How accurate is the intelligence stuff in the novels?
Vince
always
funny,
prided himself. Mm-hmm. The rap on Mitch Rapp was that the intel stuff was real. Is that true?
Yeah, I think largely that is the case. I mean, you do twist it and turn it a little bit. Obviously, if you're told stuff in confidence, that can't go very far. And Vince was just a very engaging guy, so I think people like to talk to him. And that's where you can get a lot of ideas. And then, I mean, I've gotten them that way. And then you say, okay, well, this is what happened, but I can't use that. So I'll just take some pieces of it, turn this upside down, change these names, and then nobody will really recognize it. So I think a lot of it was very, very accurate.
Yes, over here.
Hi. I was just Jerry Stanbro is my name. I was just wondering, you have more or less inherited a character that you've been working with, and I was just curious, from the way you do things, if you had to start with a totally new character, would you, in the way you do things, would you invent this character and flesh him or her out and then come up with a story that this person would do well in, or would you do it the other way, where you'd come up with a, pardon the expression, plot, mm-hmm. and then put this person in it and see how they would do?
So, well, it kind of came up with this book, Order to Kill. One of the things I was interested in throwing up against Rapp was somebody who was as good or better than him, because that's not something he'd ever faced before. He usually fought multiple terrorists. They were all very dangerous, but not super highly trained. So I tried to come up with, who would this be? And I came up with a guy named Grisha Azarov, who works for essentially Vladimir Putin as his main enforcer. He's a former Olympic athlete, spec ops guy, 10 years younger than Mitch, nowhere near the number of accumulated injuries, and sort of a situation where Mitch would have to, when he went up against him, started reeling through all his injuries and all, the fact that he didn't see as good as he used to and everything, and think, maybe this guy is going to be better than me, and this could be the end of me. So that would be an example of a guy that I thought I had sort of the plot idea for him, because I wanted to see what Mitch would do in this, if he had to face somebody like this. And then I built him sort of special built, he was purpose built for that situation. And he's much more of a kind of a me character than one that Vince. He's a little bit of a droopy dog Russian. He doesn't really like his job, but he's good at it, so he figures, why not? And so just somebody that was unlike anything that Mitch had ever faced before. And so I built him around that idea.
Using the outline and the spreadsheet and just really built?
I used to have graphs, too. I didn't tell you about the graphs.
Really?
Yeah.
What were the axes?
How interesting and every chapter. So, and how interesting every chapter was. So I didn't have big flat sections.
But how did you, who was judging?
Well, I was. Yeah. And
so,
it was the question of, what was it? It was, this has been a long time since I've done this, but it was character development, if that's what the scene was about, that was like a one. And then plot enhancement was a two, and action was a three. And I think that was the scale. And probably the most interesting thing that came out of that is I had chapters that were zeros. And I realized, I could just cut that. It didn't do anything. It had served no purpose.
Where do you work? In a coffee shop or at home? Or
Wherever. I've moved all over the house. It seemed to be wherever my wife wasn't. So
That's what she's thinking of you.
Yes. Yeah, and so I have actually written a chapter on my table saw, because my wife was just buzzing around the house. And I thought, well, I'm going to the garage. And I sat there and did it, worked there. So I finally got a desk like 2 months ago. I think it might be my first one.
Really? Mm-hmm. Wow. Congratulations.
Yeah, that's thank great. You. I feel like a real writer now.
There's a question in the back there.
So building on the idea of the character, you clearly are working with a character that you've gotten to know. So my question is, do you ever just get out of the way and let the character tell you what to write?
Oh, it happens all the time. Yeah, I mean, in this one, Mitch, I write these really, like I was saying, these very elaborate outlines. When I say they're elaborate, I mean, if I write a 100,000 page or word book, I might have a 30,000 word outline. So, I mean, these things are pretty serious. And in this one, Mitch has a relationship with this Iraqi woman that, I'd been through that outline 50 times, and I never saw it coming until I started writing it, and he started doing it, and I started saying, no, this is going to end horribly, don't do this. And he did it anyway, and it ended horribly. So That's where you want to be, right? You want to inhabit that character. And like the minute I start thinking, what would he say in this, or what would she say in this situation? I've lost it. I stop writing then, because it has to just come out, or else it feels artificial.
Yes, in the back there.
My name is Mike Brew. Two interesting things about these books. The evolution of Mitch with Stan,
With
Stan Hurley.
Oh, with Stan.
Okay, in the beginning, they were very adversarial towards each other. And then your last book, then the end came for Stan. Was that part of Vince's plan? Was that you? Or
Stan's passing?
Yes.
Yes. So there were certain things in the Mitch Rapp universe that I didn't understand.
Tell us who Stan is.
Okay, so I'm sorry. Stan is... They're actually making a movie out of this book now, and he's played by Michael Keaton. He's the grizzled old CIA operative who trains Mitch. And at first, they have a very, very adversarial relationship and really want to kill each other, but they can't figure out a way to do it. So there were things, though, in these books that I didn't fully understand. Vince was not super precise, and I am very, very precise about things, as you've noticed, about how old people are and where they came from and stuff like this. And he was a little more seat of the pants by that. So when I started, I had, for my own sanity, to straighten out the what I call the rap verse. And the rap verse has to be a place that is very concrete for me. There's nothing gray in it. He was born here, he went here, he knows this person. And so there were a couple of characters that I didn't understand. One was Stan, and the other was this guy, Louis Gould, who I just didn't understand the relationship he and Mitch had. And Stan, poor Stan, was like 84, and he was still out there on ops. And I just felt terrible for the guy. So I thought, what am I going to do? I guess because... You know, wasn't really my series, and I had such a long history. It took me forever. I was like, what am I going to do with these guys? And then one day, where you always get your great ideas in the shower, right? I'm standing in the shower, and I think, I'm just going to kill them. And you know, it was like this epiphany. Aha! And so off they went, and I never had to worry about any of that stuff anymore. So it was very much my plan to get rid of poor Stan, because the guy's just... I mean, he had cancer, he was 84 years old, all this stuff. And then to get rid of Louis, because I couldn't understand why Mitch hadn't killed him long, long ago.
Yes, go ahead.
I was wondering, did you know Vince Flynn before he died in order to take over these writings?
You know, in passing... we'd talked, and he had given me a blurb actually for one of my books, and it's kind of funny. A novelist named Brad Thor, who we had common friend, and we were friends, both friends with, years ago, had tried to set up a ski weekend. He had a house in Park City between me and Vince and Brad Meltzer and him, and. We were either on a deadline or having a kid. Everybody was either having kids or on a deadline, and we sort of never did it, and we put it off. And there's another life lesson in there. Don't put off things. We thought, oh, we'll just do it one day. We were probably in our early 30s at the time. And unfortunately, we put that off, so I never really spent any time with him. I know his family really well.
And another question about the Mitch Rapp character. Is he based on an actual person, or is... Or like a many people.
As far as being an actual composite of personalities, no. But Vince actually named all his characters after people he knew. So it's really funny to go to the Twin Cities, because you meet all the characters from his books. His Irene Kennedy is about yay big. It's his niece. And I met Rapp, who is one of his favorite customers when he was a bartender. And then you'd meet people who'd say, oh, Vince got really mad at me because I did whatever I did. I was fixing his car and it didn't work or something. So he made me this smarmy politician and killed me or something. So it's actually pretty funny to meet all those people.
Yes, go ahead.
Hi, my name's Diane. My question is, when you're writing a book, how much time do you spend researching? And I know you said that you have contacts within the FBI and stuff. Do you have contacts like with MI5 and within the Mossad and other?
Through other people. I wouldn't say I have direct contacts anymore. I used to know the MI5 and MI6 guys really well because my father had lived there. And
that's the British intelligence.
British intelligence. So a funny story, I was driving to a football game with this guy, Chris, in England. They have the thing called the American Bowl. I don't know if they still have it. It's an American football game. And we were stuck in traffic and we were going to miss the kickoff. And he said, well, I really want to see the kickoff. And, you know, my dad and I are sitting there going, what are you going to do? And, they closed the oncoming highway. We just went over the median and drove up the wrong side of the highway to get there. And I learned, I thought his initial was C because his name was Chris, but it was C as in chief, and he was M from the James Bond movies. And I said I would never tell that story until he passed away, and he just died last year. I do that kind of research early. And then a lot of it now you can really do with the internet or with the consultant. So if you were my poor mother and were reading my first draft, that's where all the little double question marks are. And then at the end I search through them all and then figure out or send them off to people who would know. But otherwise you get bogged down if you're trying to do really deep dives into research while you're writing. It's hard.
Did your mom really read all the books?
Oh, yeah. My wife hasn't read, I think, about half of them, but my mother reads. She's a champ. She reads them all.
Was she a teacher or a librarian?
No,
or?
She's just a huge thriller fan.
Wow.
So, and she was a big fan of Vince's, so she was kind of instrumental in, did I get it right? Because it's hard, you know, it's hard to look at your own writing and say, yeah, it's right. It's just right, like Vince's. But a third party who's honest with you can, so.
She calls up Kyle.
Kyle, yes.
Something about the killing on page 3.
Well, this new book, oddly, I have some stuff about fashion in it, and I just can't wait to get her comments on that. Because talk about an area I am totally ignorant of.
Yes, over there. Hey, Michael.
Callum, I'm curious how it feels to write a Vince Flynn book versus your own stories. Is one more or less satisfying? When you talk about your books, do you say, "Oh, I've written a dozen books"? Or do you kind of put them into, "I've written this pile of books and this pile of books"? Is there a difference in feeling for you?
Yeah, I think so, because my books, like I said, tended to be fairly complex and political and a little gray in morality. I mean, I wrote one book that was the entire idea at the beginning was, what makes a crime a crime? And one of my favorite characters of all time that I ever wrote is a guy named Christian Volkov, who was the biggest drug dealer in the world, but he was kind of the hero in some ways of this book. And he was an interesting guy because he thought, you know, well, I can sell alcohol, why can't I sell heroin? They're exactly the same thing to me. And so he was an interesting character morally because he didn't really see that what he did was wrong. And so with these books, so those books, you know, that was what was interesting about writing those books to me. The complexity, the learning about all kinds of things, anything from sort of moral stuff to the complex geopolitics or whatever. Vince's books, though, to me, are writing them is just like really pure fun. I mean, I seriously sit there and make machine gun noises when I'm writing them. I mean, it's just fun. You know, there's planes going down and crap's blowing up and people are getting shot and you're just hammering away air. And I sit on this stupid, now that I have a desk, I sit on one of those big Swiss balls, so I'm bouncing. and tapping away on that thing, and they're just a blast. They're a blast to read. If everybody's probably a lot of people here have read the books, they're just as fun to write as they are to read.
One more. Yes. Great. Go ahead.
Thank you very much for gracing our stage here in Traverse City. Quick question, given your parental influence and Doug's style of writing, have you ever considered writing more of a documentary rather than a novel?
Yeah, you know, I read a ton of nonfiction, so I have always wanted to write a nonfiction book. And someday I might. I just have to find just the right idea. And I had it. And a friend of mine was a former Olympian, a guy I ski with, and he'd come up with this idea that he's about my age, that if he just doped himself to the gills, that he might be able to come back to the top of the sport. And he wanted to, we'd do a book together, and it would just be all about him just doping the hell out of himself to see how strong he could get. And I was dying to do that book, but then I thought, oh my God, I might kill him. And so it never, and then we couldn't figure out the ethics of it, because he would actually be winning these races and taking that away from clean athletes. So we never could work it out. But so it's funny, my agent is Mr. No, and like they all are, right?
Mr. No?
Yeah, he's just Mr. No. Everything I throw at him is Mr. No. And I pitched him that, and he was like, I'll take it. But we just ended up never doing it. So that was my big idea. So I'm waiting for another good one to come along.
That's funny. What kind of nonfiction do you read? Do you read history or memoir?
Yeah, all kinds of stuff. Yeah. Memoir.
But you don't read thrillers, really?
Not too many. You know, I obviously read Vince's, and I read ones that people send me to put quotes on, to blurb. But to me, I'm always concerned that I'm going to get my voice a little bit mixed up with mm-hmm. with theirs, because, you know, you read these things and then you'd forget, did I make that up or did I read it somewhere? And that always worries me. So I'm light on those.
Mm-hmm. Listen, Kyle Mills, thank you so very much. Yeah, the book is Order to Kill.